been baptized and you want to be baptized, talk to my dad or I. We can even plan on going through just a little bit of instruction on baptism, just what it's about. And we'd love to have you be included in being baptized 3 weeks from today. That's July 18th. 6 p.m. We'll have that down at Andy and Sally's Pond. Let's start with Megan. We're going to have Megan, my mom, and then Dan and Jess will come and share about the trip. So let's start with Megan.
Fun. We also, after VBS, some days, well, all the days, we would also work a little bit. So we were able to build two shelves for a lady who, as a ministry, she kind of has a garage sale like all year round for people who aren't really able to afford things. People donate things to her, and we were able to build her some shelves for that. And we also put in some insulation for someone in like a crawl space where there was spiders, but it was good. It was a lot of fun, and it was good.
Well, this was my first trip to West Virginia, and it's not a vacation. We were up every morning by 5:30. And, you know, 10, 11 o'clock at night, but we did have a couple hours in the afternoon free time, which was very refreshing. The kids were great, just great. We worked in a trailer that no one should ever live in those conditions. And I think we brought some comfort and joy to Karen. I'd have liked to have been there another week because there seemed like a lot more to do. But one of the big things on our project was there was so much junk. I think that we filled 200 contractor garbage bags, which are like this big. Some of them very, very heavy. And the kids toted those garbage bags up a steep, steep hill and put them in a pig pen. And I heard two of the girls laughing. I thought maybe they were crying, but they were laughing. And one said to the other, "This is fun." And the other girl says, "Oh, this is so much fun." And I'm thinking, really?
And this year, Jesse did almost 100% of the running between projects, making sure people had what they needed, and just taking care of that stuff. So I like to brag on my wife a little bit, and she did an awesome job on that. The project that I worked on, we were repairing a bridge that was made. I've heard 30s, 40s, 50s, you know, So we don't know how old it was, but it was a pipe bridge that these five families used to get back to their houses. And
no one maintains it.
Yeah, no one maintains it. It still worked, so it didn't get fixed.
People would drive across it and not wear their seatbelts because it was so sketchy that they feared that they'd have to bail.
And as we started, as you start taking things apart, it goes, oh, this is worse than we thought. Oh, wow, this is fun. So at the end of the week, we had that, looking a lot better. What else?
I was basically the chauffeur for the VBS kids. They did it completely by themselves this year. I thought it was great. Of course, they're not really kids anymore. I mean, young adults, and they did a wonderful job. I first got there as, the leader of the project or the VBS team or whatever. I'm like, all right, this is not my jam. I want to go build something. So that was kind of a weird transition for me, but I loved it. There was some kids that attached on to each of us and were kind of our buddies all week. We enjoyed being able to do some nitty gritty projects in the afternoon this year. It was a small crew. We loved it. It was intentionally smaller this year, and I think that we probably won't go back to having 58 people again. It's a lot to manage, and it's basically too small of a place to have that many people. So we really enjoyed the more intentional relationships with everybody this year. The kids, zero complaints. I cannot believe. There's three girls that toted all that crap up to the pig pen, and they work harder than anybody else on the trip, and they never complained. They were just full of joy the whole time. I mean, smiling. It was disgusting. But but they did a really good job. What else did we do? We had, a couple of our projects were larger than we had anticipated, like Dan said. The ramp was significantly more of a project than what I had personally planned on, but Jim Crawford has built like over 200 of them, so he quickly came up with a new plan and still got it done way before we even intended to. So one day I was leaving a work site, I said, Micah, do you need anything? He goes, we're gonna need more work. So I'm like, all right, we'll figure something out. So we kicked butt this week. The demo, we were not intending to be able to get anywhere near what we did done, and they just worked so hard. Long days, hot weather. The weather cooperated fairly well this year. But I was really impressed. We had a lot of, everybody did their job, which is so nice. That was part of our intention, is taking a smaller crew, having it be more young adults rather than like middle school, high school sort of deal. And everybody had a huge part, and that's the only reason that the whole trip happens, is everybody had a lot of responsibility this year, and I thought everyone did a wonderful job with that.
So this is kind of how everything always works out with Rock. This is Ephesians chapter 3, verses 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations forever and ever. We had a plan, and we thought we were doing pretty good with it. And we were done with our plan Wednesday around noon. And God said, oh, you got another day and a half. Let's see what we can get done now. And just how the things that we can't control, like the weather, best weather we've had, and just so many things that could have been issues that God said, oh, you don't need to deal with that today. You don't need to deal with that this week. I got that. You'll be good. So to God be the glory, great things he has done.
Awesome. Did you change your mind, Jordan? Do you want to say anything? No, it's okay, good. Jordan was on the trip too. Great, great contributor. Let's continue our worship with singing.
Okay, everyone can stand. We're going. In a second, we're going to start our singing with the song, How Great Is Our God. Mm-hmm. sure.
I worship you.
we're singing is What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
Thank you.
that Jesus has come to pay the price once and for all, for all our sin. And thank you, Lord, that it is as simple as looking to Jesus, of acknowledging, Lord, that you, Jesus, you have come to die in our place and that we need you. We acknowledge our sinfulness and we thank you that you have died in our place and we receive this gift. And it's because of you standing as our advocate and you, Lord, washing our hearts whiter than snow. This is what gives us confidence to come before you, because you have even called us to bring our request to you. And so, Lord, because of Jesus, and because we trust that it's true, not in our own worthiness, for without you we are unworthy, we come to you, Lord, with boldness. And we pour our hearts out to you for needs that we each have, for needs that our friends, family, community has. For the world, Lord, for this hurting world, there is no answer except Jesus. And so, Lord, we pray in these last days that you would honor your word, as we know you always do. You never go back on your word. And in the last days, you will pour out your spirit. Oh, God, pour out your spirit here in America and around the world. And we pray specifically for Carbonera in the Dominican today. We thank you for those you have sent, those who are there ministering on your behalf. And we pray, O Lord, that there would be many hearts turned to you, and that the church would be encouraged and rise up to do all the work you have given them to do. We pray, Lord, that even the shamans and witch doctors, those who practice evil, would be arrested by your truth and your grace. We pray, Lord, that spiritual darkness would be pushed back and that light would shine and that you would receive the victory in that community. And Lord, here even in our community, we pray for those who are far from you and yet near if they just bow their heart and receive the truth. And so we pray, Lord, that even in dreams and visions, through our conversations, through any means possible, Lord, that you would have mercy on those we love who live near us, who don't yet know of your love for them. And Lord, we lift up to you these requests. Thank you for calling Erin to camp, and we pray, Lord, that you would minister to her every need and grow her this summer, as well as use her to bless others. And God, we pray for Logan Mullen as he recovers this week from brain surgery. We pray, Lord, that you would be near to him, that he would cry out to you, that he would find his every need met in Christ, and that you, Lord, would bring healing to his mind, his brain, and restore him to health and now, God, we join our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Okay, Dad, please preach us the word.
What the song we sang, Waymaker, was our theme for the week. We had five teachings on there, and if any of you would like to get Jordan's teaching, he's got it. He got it printed out, and I'll tell you, it was more than you could digest in one setting, so it's a great great thing. If you want to get that, he ought to be writing a book, but we had wonderful time there. Wonderful times of worship, wonderful times of teaching, and it was just very enriching. And today I'm going to be preaching, continuing this series. We're working our way through Genesis, and the patriarchs, when they call on the the nation of Israel's patriarch, it's always Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And we know from Jacob we go to the 12 tribes of Israel. But history, why is it important? Because if you don't know where you come from, you don't know where you're going. And God's history was making this nation. This is critical because here in this lesson today, we find where the nation of Israel actually gets its name. It comes from God, and it comes, we'll get to that in a minute. But as you know, if you've been following along the saga of Abraham and then Isaac, and now Isaac has Rebekah, his wife, and they're having trouble. But last week we saw that Isaac and Rebekah had two children, and they were twins. And they found out, they went to seek the Lord because she was having so much trouble during that pregnancy. They sought the Lord as to what was going on. And he says, there's two nations inside you. And he said at that time, and this is critical to understand, that the younger would serve the older. Now, we're going to see how that works out. And I don't think it was God's way it would have worked out. But God honors even our mistakes. And so as these two children were born, it says Esau was very hairy, and his brother come out holding his heel, and that's where he got his name. He was the supplanter. If we was to give him a nickname today, we would call him the schemer. And so they didn't call him schemer, but, you know, that's kind of the nickname he would have come up with if he grew up in our day and age, because he was always thinking ahead of how he could get the best of something. And it showed out as he went, as they went through their life, his brother, it said his brother was one who hunted, and he liked to stay around the tents. And as it turns out, he was his mother's favorite boy, which is a thing that goes on to the next generation as well. As one thing we see here is there's generational sins that sometimes plague us because it's something our mothers and fathers tended to teach us not intending to. But when we do something one way and say it another way, we will teach what we're doing. And that's why it's so critical. And when we have generational sin, if it comes to you from your parents, it's so important that it has to be renounced. You need to get that taken care of under the blood of Jesus and out of your life, so it will not be a hamper to your kid's life. But we see that happening here, as we'll see in the life of Jacob's 12 sons. But as it turned out, Jacob got the birthright from his brother through a scheme. He'd come back from hunting, he was famished, he thought he was about to die, and his brother had a pot of stew fixing there, and he says, I'll give you my birthright for a pot of that, a dish of that soup. And he traded it off. And the birthright, that's something we don't really understand, but it means he got, as a birthright, he got the double, twice as much as everybody else in the family. That was just the way things were done. And I know this story troubles me because as we get to the blessing, as Isaac gets near death, he's blind, and he comes to a time that he's going to put his blessing on one of his sons. And this always bothered me when I read this, because I had three boys, and I could not imagine trying to bless one more than the other. And so the blessing is a big thing. And we're taught from Jesus, one thing he taught us when Jesus was here on earth, he taught us that we should even bless our enemies. We're not supposed to hold this blessing for one person. And so that's different than it was in those days and in that tradition. But the blessing was a big deal. And Isaac got ready to put his blessing, which was a bigger blessing than most of us in our society or in our families carry, because it carried with it the promise that God had promised even Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, that they would be someone one day that would come that would bless all the nations and all the peoples, that he has the power to bless all the peoples of the earth. And we know that is the person of Jesus Christ. Well, I was coming through this family. So part of that blessing wasn't just the Lord bless you and keep you. It was the blessing of God's promise. And in this thing, this is where every family has a bit of dysfunction to it. I don't believe there's probably been a perfect family on the earth. So every family probably has a bit of dysfunction. Some are very obvious. It's easy to see. And others are somewhat subtle. But every family probably has a portion of dysfunction, and that's something we have to deal with. But you know, if God can use a schemer and a supplanter, He can use you and me. He can certainly use somebody who's upright in heart and tries to live their life with integrity. Jesus certainly did, and nobody was used more than he was by God. So God can use any of us, and that's something to keep in mind, because even as the blessing comes down for the time of the blessing, is what happened as Isaac said, I'm getting old. You know, I don't know when this is going to happen, but someday I'm going to be gone. And before I go, I've got one big responsibility. I have to pass this blessing from my father and my grandfather onto my son. And so he said, I'm going to do it to the oldest son, because that was tradition, right? Even though when they inquired of the Lord had told them very specifically, the younger will serve the older. So the younger was to get the blessing. The father didn't do it that way. But what happened? Mama was listening in when he said, Esau out. He says, go get some game, fix the food the way I love it, and bring it to me. I'll eat it, and then I'll give you the blessing. But Rachel heard this. Rebecca heard this, and she went to her son, Jacob, and said, quickly, go get two lambs. We're going to get this done, and we got to. And Jacob didn't really want to, because he says, hey, I'm nothing like my brother. I can't fool my dad. And when she says, don't worry, we'll take some goat skin, we'll put the hair on your arm. You know, you wear some of Esau's clothes, you'll smell like him. And it was fascinating, because when he came before his father, he says, are you Esau? You smell like Esau? You feel like Esau? But you don't sound like Esau. You remember Jesus, that teaching, he says, if my people will hear my voice, they will follow me. And so that's critical. I just think it was kind of interesting, the fact that he was deceived in every way but the voice that he heard. But he asked him outright, he says, are you my son Esau? And Jacob said, yes, I am. Probably tried to disguise his voice. And so you see, this was riddled with lies and deceit and deception. And even with his mother, he says, I fear a curse, because if my dad finds out I'm trying to trick him, I might be cursed rather than blessed. And his mother says, don't worry about that. If it's cursed, let the curse come on me, because I'm putting you up to this. So you see how this dysfunction works in a family. And yes, God's will gets done, but God would have done it if he had just blessed the younger son. And that was part of it. But the scheming doesn't stop here, because once the blessing had been given, then there's this bitter, I was going to read it. Maybe I won't, because I might be a little short on time and I got to get to the important stuff. But this whole thing, when Esau comes back, he's bitterly lamenting the fact. He says, Dad, I've got the game. I'm fixing it up. Get ready for a meal. And he says, wait, who was that I just blessed? And the story unfolds. He says, wait. You must have a blessing for me. And he says, nope, the blessing I have given, you will serve your brother. And he just begged for a blessing, because he just longed for that. And I think every heart longs for a blessing from their father. And that's something we have to know, that we have to be able to bless. As you as a father, you don't bless one child over another. And I think that we see that thing happening even in the next life. Now, God uses it. Yes, God can use everything. But I think God has a perfect plan. If we'll let his plan play out, it'll be better for everybody than if we just try to get in the middle and mess it up. But after he had blessed, he says, now, I don't want you taking one of these heathen wives to affect our family. You go back to your mother's family and take a wife from there. And so that's what he does. 850 miles. He sets out on this journey, 850 miles, to hike to his uncle Laban's house. And when he gets there, on the way, he has this place. And it's fascinating, because sometimes when you understand that God's interested in you personally, not just everybody. He is interested in everybody, but he has a way of sometimes zeroing in on you and showing you that you're special. And when he did this, this happened to Jacob. As he went, he's getting ready to go to bed in this place he didn't really know. He found a pillow of a stone and put it there, and he laid down and he slept. And while he was sleeping, he had this dream, and he saw the heavens open. God was standing at the top, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on this ladder. And he woke up and he says, by golly, I stumbled into the door of heaven. And you know, that's the way we all tend to find God, is we somehow stumble into God's presence, and it's revealed to us who God is. And he thought he had literally found the opening to heaven. And he had this dream, and he promised God that he would serve him well if he would bring him back to that place. Because he was just starting on his journey of 850 miles, knowing nothing about the future. You know, that's a way we all are. We know what the past has been, and what the past has been, the past has been, but the future is yet to come. And it only comes one day at a time. So he made his commitment to God there if he would bring him back. Well, the journey goes on as he travels. He ends up at this place he was supposed to. There's a bunch of sheep gathered at this well, which is covered. And they wait till all the sheep get there. Then they uncover the well and they water the sheep. Well, as this happens, it just so happens, they says, hey, what's going on here? You know, all the sheep are gathered and nobody's doing anything. He says, we're waiting for Laban's sheep to get here. So they come, and Rebekah's leading the sheep, and this was truly love at first sight. He saw her and he fell in love, and that's who his wife was to be. But as the story unfolds, he went on and he gets to the place where he has this conversation. And he has a conversation with Laban, and it's about his daughter, because he comes there, and in this society, if you had a daughter, it was expected you would get a gift if he was going to be your wife. So he comes there with absolutely nothing. He fled because he was afraid Esau would kill him, because he had taken advantage, he had schemed out of his brother, not once, but twice, and his brother was furious. And so because of this, he fled, and his mother told him where to go, his father told him where to go, and what he was to do there. And so when he gets there, he finds the place he's going, he falls in love with this beautiful young lady, but he has nothing to offer. And he offers to work for his uncle Laban, and he does that. And then he says, how about if I work 7 years for your daughter's hand, and she will be my wife? He agrees to that. And then he works for 7 years, and it says it seemed like it was but a day. And so when the wedding time comes, I don't know whether they had too much wine or whatever, but when the time to come consummate the marriage, when he woke up in the morning, he had the older sister, not his beloved wife that he loved. And so the agreement was that, okay, if he promised to work 7 more years for his other daughter, that would be the dowry you'd pay. But one thing happened in there that Laban began to notice: everything that Jacob had his hand on, God seemed to bless. And so it was good for him. But after he had paid off the 14 years of debt, he said, well, what should your wages be? And they come up with this idea that if all the spotted sheep would be his and all the regular colored sheep would be Laban's. Laban was a schemer just like his sister was. And he thought he could get the best of Jacob. But the one problem Laban had was God was in the process of blessing Jacob. Why? God promised it. God promised Abraham he would bless his descendants. And here, what happened? Now, it seemed like Jacob was a schemer, and it seemed like he had his own little breeding seminar going on there. He taught the certain sheep to stand in front of certain. He stripped poles and taught them to stand still. So when it come time to breed, he bred all the healthier animals, crossbred them. And so what happened? They all come out. I mean, Laban says, okay, you got the spotted one this time. How about you only get the striped ones this year? Well, it goes on to say, when he's having this conversation with Laban about when the breakup was taking place, that Every time he changes his wages 10 times, it says in there, several times. It says you change his wages 10 times, and 10 times God made things work out to the advantage of who? Jacob. So Jacob was this schemer, and it seemed like he schemed and he schemed and he schemed, and he always come out on the winning edge. And but when he met his uncle Laban, he met a schemer of his own match, and they schemed together, but God always blessed Jacob. And this came to the great frustration, because as those 6 years progressed, all of a sudden, Jacob's flock was bigger and Laban's flock was lesser. And so the brothers of his wives suddenly said, you know what? Jacob being here is not a good thing. We're seeing him get most of my dad's flock, all his riches, and he's just going to disappear with them, and we're going to be left with nothing. Well, Jacob's heard this same story, so he says, when the time come for shearing sheep, and Laban went down to shear his sheep, he had a lot of camels. He had a lot of things, and he put his children, so he starts this 850-mile trek back to the place where Abraham was. God sent Abraham, and he was to return, and he promised God he would return there one day if God would watch over him. And God had watched over him and blessed him, so he starts making this 850-mile trek back with all these animals, his 11 kids and everything. And when he gets going, his uncle finds out he's gone. He chases him down, and he was about to deal pretty harshly with him because he thought he was the older. But God came in a dream that night and said, don't deal harshly with my servant Jacob, because he has my anointing on him, and you do not want to be on the other side of that. And so it ended up, even though he wanted to deal pretty harshly with his son-in-law, he dealt with him graciously because God had warned him. And so Jacob goes on to get back, but he's got one more hurdle. And this is where, if things had been done with more integrity, he wouldn't be coming back to this big mess. He feared his brother. When he left, his brother would have loved to kill him. Well, he's got to go back to where his brother lives, and he's going back, and he has this great fear. And it's not the prettiest picture when you think of somebody with honor and dignity. What's he do? He puts his wife that he doesn't love as much and her kids out here. He puts his wife he loves more in the middle, and then he stays clear in the back. He's just going to see how things play out when they come to his brother Esau. And so all this thing happens, as he's preparing to meet Esau the next day, this event happens, and it comes to the place where he wrestles with God. And this is where it's so important, because you and I wrestle with God. You know, sometimes we pray. We know what we want, and we're praying, asking God to do it. We're wrestling with him. And if we would just yield to his way, his will, things would be better for us and God. Well, Jacob wrestled with God all night long. And when the angel of the Lord realized that he was not getting anywhere with Jacob's submission, he simply touched him on the hip. And you would think he'd have just walked away, left Jacob limping, but no, Jacob grabbed a hold of him and says, don't go until you bless me. See, he had an idea. He was dealing with deity, but he didn't know for sure. But he was not about to yield to God. He wrestled with God. He struggled with God. He fought with God all night long. And as what happened before he left, he said, isn't it something you ask my name? And he said, what is your name? He said, my name's Jacob. And he says, it will no longer be called Jacob, no longer be called schemer. You're not going to be the schemer anymore. You will be called Israel. And El is the name of God. And Israel in Hebrew means one that will bring his submission, will submit to God Almighty. And so this was to be Jacob's changing moment. Now, he changed Abraham's name, he changed Jacob's name, and he changed Saul's name. Now, why that's important to God, I don't know. But do we need a name change? I don't know. Andy works pretty good for me, has all my life, and probably will. But, and it's not so much that I need a name change as my heart needs a change. And that's what Jacob needed. And I don't know if there's too much story in Jacob's life where he was a schemer after this. He came under the rule of God. He willingly put himself there, but he struggled all night long. He fought all night long. And then he was amazed when this, when he got spoken to that way, he says, yipes, I've been in the presence of God and I'm still alive to tell about it. Because when Moses wanted to be in God's presence, he was in God's presence a lot. But he says, hey, if you and I are friends, I ought to be able to speak to you as I speak to you. Face to face. None of this cloud, all this other stuff. He knew God. He knew God better than most people because he saw him at work over and over again. But he said, I just want to meet face to face with you. And God says, that just can't happen, because if you do, you're going to disintegrate. There's just no way you can be in my presence. So remember, he covered him with his hand in the cleft of a rock and passed by, and he glowed for 40 days so much that other people couldn't talk to him because his face was shining so brightly. So this is something that Jacob really changed him. It was a moment, more than a moment with him, because he realized he had wrestled, he had struggled with God. He resisted God all night long. And then when he finally yielded to his and sought, because he asked, he says, don't leave until you bless me. You know, you bless me. He had been blessed by his father. He sort of knew what that was about. But he needed it one more time. And when he came to his brother, they were able to have peace. His brother comes, gives him a hug and a kiss and says, what are you worried about? That was a long time ago. But you know, to Jacob, he still dealt with all those insecurities of dealing with people wrongly in the past. And that's the way you and I have to do it. If we work in our integrity, you can come to anybody, look them in the face, and not feel guilty. But if you've schemed and tricked people all your life, when you come to deal with them, you're going to have stuff you're going to have to deal with yourself. And that's never easy. So just the fact that God comes, and now we know the nation of Israel as Israel. That's where their name came from. But when they come to talk about the patriarchs, they don't say, our patriarchs, Israel. No, they say Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But Jacob's name was changed to Israel, and that's where they get their identity from. And they're still supposed to be a nation that comes under God's authority, under God's rule. Even when they wanted a king, they came to a place where they said, we want a king. And God said to them, please don't do this. I want to be your king. When you have a problem, you come ask me, and I will answer you. And they said, no, all the other nations have a king. We'd like a king. So what'd God do? What he does often gives us the desire of our heart. You know, we're made in God's image. When we desire something bad enough, we'll probably make it happen. And God doesn't stop that. He doesn't come down and say, nope, it's only going to happen my way. Now, God's will can have a way of getting done, as Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for good to those that are called according to God's purpose. And you can do everything wrong, and God's will can still somehow get done. And I have a good friend who feels real guilty because he felt like he was called to be a pastor, and he never did that. And he just laments that. And I says, hey, God can always take you from where you are to where he wants you to be. And it's not something like you have to have made all the right decisions earlier to make a right one now. No, you can make a right decision now. And that's all it takes. You can always move to where God wants you to be. You don't have to go back and try to relive your life. You can be forgiven of everything in the past, and the future is wide open. And so that's the way it was with Jacob. Amen. Now, Jacob had some sins in his life, and as we get into the next chapter of the 12 patriarchs, you'll see there's lots of dysfunction in that family too. But is God limited to only perfect functional families? No, he can use everybody's family. He can use you, whether you came from a total dysfunctional family or only a partial one. I'm sure my family had issues that were not perfect. And, you know, try as hard as I might, I didn't do it right. And God doesn't mean God somehow can't use me or can't use any of my family. No, we can overcome everything that's present in our life. And that would be something I would encourage us to do here, because if we struggle with God, you know, there's nothing will beat that quicker than yielding to Him. Because when we yield to God, all of a sudden we got God on our side. When we struggle against Him, we make Him our enemy. Unintentionally, quite often, because when we're praying, I know what needs to get done. It's got to be done this way. And God, if you're not seeing it, it's not happening. But sometimes when we give up and say, Lord, I don't know what the problem is, but you do. And suddenly things work out. And that's the way it works, because we struggle against God, we're not going with Him. But when we yield to Him, He will give us the next step. And that's just the way it goes. And it's several chapters. I didn't get into reading. I've had three sections I was going to read because they're kind of critical. But I did want to get to the end of this story. And so the next story is the 12 tribes of Israel. And we will go on with that. But the story of Jacob is one that's very, very interesting, because God can take somebody that's didn't do it right, but God can still use him, because God had called him. He called on God's name. He made a promise, if you'll bring me back here, I'll serve you. And he did. But he got his name changed in the meantime, and that stuck, because the nation of Israel is still known as the nation of Israel. So let's pause for a moment of prayer. Father, we're grateful that You've called us to be a part of Your plan, the church. And we know we don't always get it right. We don't always get it perfect. But we know Your plan never changes. You want people to see You for who You are. So help each one of us to represent You well. To present what You've done for us that others might receive. And Lord, we're grateful that You call us to be a part, and You've anointed us each with Your Spirit to have our part in Your church, even though it's different from everybody else's. So Father, we ask that You take each one of our lives and use them, Lord, for Your glory. Help us be a part of Your church that will cause Your glory to be seen. Because the day is coming when we will celebrate with You in eternity. And we don't want to be there without our friends with us. For Father, we come, we give ourselves to You. We ask You to change our hearts where they need changing. And just give us the joy of the Lord. We know You came that You might give us life, and give us life in more abundance than we've ever known before. We're not trying to qualify what that looks like, but we just know it's good. And so we ask for Your goodness to be poured out in our land, in our nation, in our country, and in this world. We know there's lots of evil, but we know the good will always overcome the evil. So Father, we just proclaim, we decree that goodness have its way in our land today, because of what God's done on our behalf and what Jesus has paid for. But Father, I just come, I now pronounce a blessing on this congregation on this day. May Your face shine on us and be gracious to us. And let us give You glory, Lord. For we come and say it in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Now go in peace.
There's a place that you're safe and I want you to see. I don't care if it hurts, crash into me. Let tomorrow clear the smoke. There's a spark in your heart, that's all you need. Let me be your trail of gasoline. Don't let the fire get too low. When you're tired of faith and searching for a sign, I'll be